which is why Jesus hated religion, and for it he called them fools. Don't you see, so much better?
Losing my religion, trying to keep
up. Religion might preach grace, but another thing they practice tend to ridicule God's people.
So once I saw this guy on a bridge and he was about to jump, and I said, "Don't do it, don't do it." And he said to me, "But nobody loves me." And I said, "God loves you." And then I asked him, "Hey, do you believe in God?" And he said, "Yeah." And so I said, "Well, are you a Christian or are you a Jew?" And he said, "I'm a Christian." And I said, "Me too." I said, are you Protestant or are you Catholic?" And he said, "I'm a Protestant." And I said, "Oh, me too. What denomination?" He said, I'm Baptist. I said, "Me too, I'm a Baptist. Northern Baptist or Southern Baptist?" He said, "Northern Baptist." I said, "Me too, wow. Northern Conservative Baptist or Northern Liberal Baptist?" He said, "Northern Conservative Baptist." I couldn't believe it. "Me too. Northern Conservative Baptist King James region or Northern Baptist Conservative NIV region?" He said, "Northern Conservative Baptist King James region." I said, "Me too." "Northern Conservative Baptist King James region Council of 1879 or Northern Conservative Baptist King James region Council of 1912. He paused. He said, "Northern Conservative Baptist King James Region Council of 1912. I said, "What? What? Die, you heathen!" And I pushed him off the bridge. You're probably wondering what that's all about. I'll tell you what it's all about. It's all about religion. And thanks for joining me today on a journey that will hopefully end with you and me losing our religion. And boy, do we need to lose it. And I want to give you some tools over this session. If you've not seen the other sessions, they're all available here, wherever you're watching, maybe on live stream, on Facebook, on Life Church Wimslow, or on our Life Church Wimslow YouTube page. Go and check out the last two sessions of the other sessions. But I want to give you some tools to help you take a stand against religion. I've told you already, I've been a follower of Jesus Christ for many years, and the biggest battle that I have faced during those years has been religion. Nothing compares to the constant pull in my soul to become religious. And just like that illustration then, you know, the signs are very scary. The signs usually are things like being judgmental and critical, and when you feel like you're doing really good and you're better than everybody else, or on the other side of the coin, discouragement, usually from expecting more from myself than even Jesus expects. You know, so you can swing like a pendulum between those two areas of life, between feeling discouraged and down or doing really good. And then you get judgmental and you become critical of everything, and it's like a vicious circle, and then you feel discouraged again. And so I want to just help you in this session, if that's you, if that speaks to you, of how you can really break religion in your life. And it's really scary as well, like again, that illustration of how religion can easily creep into our churches also. You know, religion is there when we think our church, our flavour of church, how we do church or what we believe is better than everybody else. It's an easy trap to fall into. So whoever you are, wherever you're watching today, no matter how long you've been a follower of Christ, here's the warning: you are never far away from the danger of replacing your relationship with Jesus Christ with the rituals and the outward forms of religion. Now, I'm not saying, let me just make this clear, I'm not saying that the rituals are wrong in themselves, but they are totally wrong when they become just meaningless, empty and fake. We did a test on that last week. If you were watching on the live stream, we actually did a quiz, and the quiz was a very simple little quiz, and it was this: which one of these is church? Some of you might have seen this last week. which one of these is church? And there was a coffee, a cappuccino going in the cars in the park after church to actually honour the person who got this right. And it was a simple little quiz, but you see, it had a serious message to it, because during lockdown, one of my rituals of going to a building that I call church on a Sunday at 10 o'clock in the morning was taken away. And it was the religious part of me that really struggled with that. It was that bit of religion that I've still got, that I'm still working on in my soul, that struggled with that whole idea of, like, I don't go to a church anymore on a Sunday morning at 10 o'clock with my friends and do church. And the truth is this, that I've come to realise during COVID-19, that a relationship can survive and even thrive, whether it's in a park, a house, or even in a prison. Just ask the Apostle Paul, just read some of his books that were written in prison. A relationship does not depend on the building, it doesn't really depend on where we do life together and where we have church. And maybe you're watching today and you've never even been in a church. Well, I want to encourage you, you're in exactly the right place right now. Keep watching, don't tune out, don't watch something else. Stay right here, because I've got something to say specifically to you. At the beginning of this live stream, there's a clip from a song, one of my favourite songs from the 90s. Now, if you're a bit younger than the ages of 40, maybe you won't remember this, but one of my favourite bands of the 90s was REM, and they did this song called Losing My Religion. I'm just going to show you a clip.
That's me in the corner. That's me in the spotlight. Losing my religion. Don't know if I can do it. Oh no, I've said too much. I haven't said enough.
I still love that. 20, 30 years later, still love that song. And there's a great line in there from Michael Stipe, who wrote the song. He said this, that's me in the corner, that's me in the spotlight, losing my religion, trying to keep up with you, and I don't know if I can do it. I don't know if I can do it. And I love that line, because that basically in one line sums up religion. Religion says do, do, do. A relationship with Jesus Christ, a spiritual, real, refreshing, lasting relationship with Jesus Christ is all about done, done, done. Religion says, I obey to be accepted. I serve, I work to get forgiveness. Religion says, I do holy things and righteous things to be accepted. And it says, you know, to earn more of God's love, I will give more, pray more, try and be more. But a relationship doesn't say those things. A relationship with Jesus says, because I'm accepted already, I obey. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. There's still obedience in there, but it's because I'm accepted, because I'm loved, that I obey. It's because I'm forgiven. And I just can't get my head around that. Why would God forgive me of all the things of my past? Because I'm forgiven, I want to serve. Because I'm already declared righteous in his sight, no matter what I do, because he says I'm righteous, I want to do things that are right. I want to do things that are good out of a response to Jesus. Paul said this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He said, what is it now? I've got the verse here. Yeah. God made him, 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So what is my response when Jesus, when God calls me righteous? My response is, I'm so thankful. I want to live a holy life. I want to please him. I'm in a relationship now. I won't always make it. I won't always live up to that. But it's not a striving, because he already says, my son, you are already righteous. There is not one thing I can do to get God to love me more and to have more of him in my life. There's not one thing I can do. It's already done. It was done at the cross. That's why they call it the good news. That's why it's not religion. That's why it's so far away from religion. Last week I saw this t-shirt. I've got a picture of it here. a great t-shirt in Amsterdam. That's where I was last week, and it says this. It's a popular t-shirt. Good boys go to heaven, bad boys go to Amsterdam. Good boys go to heaven, bad boys go to Amsterdam. And it's a nice t-shirt, but it really frustrates me every time I see it, because both of those sentences are totally wrong. For a start, there's loads of great people in Amsterdam. It's not all bad people, especially the boys that go there. Sometimes they get up to bad things, doesn't make them bad. But secondly, the very first sentence really gets under my skin when it says, good boys go to heaven. Listen, there is nobody good going to heaven. Let me just make that clear. There is nobody good going to heaven. If that was the case, then Moses would not be in heaven, because Moses was a murderer. If that was the case, Abraham from the Bible wouldn't be in heaven, because he was a liar, a pathological liar. That's what he was. David would not be there. David was both an adulterer and a murderer. And then there's Rahab. Check out Rahab. She's in the genealogy of Jesus, for goodness sake. She was a prostitute. What about Noah? We hear the stories. Noah's Ark. Yeah, he was a drunk. Read the story. What about Elijah? He was a suicidal. I don't know what was going on in his head, but he wanted to take his life. All of these people that the Bible records and tells their stories, if you take time to read, none of them were perfect, and none of them could really be called good. No, it's not good people who go to heaven. It's forgiven people who go to heaven. It is saved people who go to heaven. It's people who are in friendship, in connection, in relationship with the living person, Jesus Christ. In closing, I just want to give us three things. I promised this last week, and I'm going to close with this. Three things that Jesus gives us when he comes into our life. These three things that Jesus gives us, and again, I could make a long list. I'm just going to give you three this morning. These three things are also, they're good identifiers of people who have a relationship with Jesus and are not religious. So that what I'm sharing right now is kind of killing two birds with one stone. I'm telling you right now how to have a relationship with Jesus and what those things will produce. But I'm also telling you that here's a good identifier of whether you've got a bit of religion in your heart or not, or you can look around and maybe see, okay, that's religion and that's real. That's counterfeit, that's real. That's fake, that is genuine. So here we go. Here's the three things. Are you ready? Do you want to write these down? Humble, confident, joy. Humble, confident, joy. First thing really that you spot in the life of somebody who has a relationship with Jesus Christ is deep, deep humility. The type of humility that says, yep, you know what? You're right. I did nothing to deserve my salvation. I do not deserve anything that comes from Jesus. I can't boast about anything in my life. I'm a sinner. Hands up. It's not about how good I am. It's about how good Jesus is. I wonder if somebody has ever said to you, you've been telling them about your relationship with Jesus, and they've said to you, you're a Christian, but hey, you're no better than me. What's the answer to that? What's the response? Yes, absolutely right. It's true. I am no better than you. And more than that, I could bring you a long line of people, a long line of people today on this live stream, and show you that they are better than me, better fathers, better me life, maybe better husbands. They have better relationships. Maybe they're nicer. Maybe they do better things for poor people. I could give you a long line of people today. And when you share things like that, it just blows people away. Hey, do you want to know about my thought life? There's another level altogether. Not about just what I do and what they do. What about our thought lives? Right then, oh no, I don't want anybody to know about my thought life. I am a sinner saved by grace. Nothing that Jesus does or has done in my life did I deserve or will I deserve in the future. So the first thing is humble, humility. The second thing is humble confidence. Yeah, I'm not there yet. Yeah, I still struggle. Do you want the list? But my sins are forgiven, and I have an advocate with God the Father in heaven. He said he will never leave me. He knows me better than anybody in the world knows me, and yet loves me unconditionally. He said things to me like he will supply all of my needs according to his riches in glory. He calls me his son. I mean, I don't deserve this stuff. I don't deserve any of that. And the amazing thing is, he is faithful, and he is patient, and he is loving. And here's the good news for me, especially for me, maybe not for you, but for me, and he hasn't finished with me yet. Again, do you see my vocabulary now? It's not about me, it's all about him. And although I'm not where I should be, I am changing and being renewed. And although I'm not where I should be, I'm not where I was. That's the only testimony I can give you today about my walk and my relationship with Jesus. Starts in humility, it stays there, but it moves on to an immense confidence in the one that I have a relationship with. The Apostle Paul put it very simply this way in Ephesians chapter 2. He says this in the Message version: saving is all his idea and all his work. All we do is trust him enough to let him do it. It's God's gift from start to finish. We don't play the major role. If we did play the major role, we'd probably go around bragging that we'd done the whole thing ourselves. No, we neither make nor save ourselves. God does both the making and the saving. He creates each of us by Christ Jesus to join him in the work he does. The good work he has gotten ready for us to do, the work we had better be doing. Do you see that? Do you see that message at the end there? It goes from all that Jesus has done, but yeah, there are things to be done. Yes, there is a service when you join God's kingdom, but it doesn't come out of religion. It doesn't come out of forcing. It doesn't come out of having to do something, gritting your teeth and do it in pain. It comes out of that loving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Humble, confident, and joyful. Here's the last one. Left the best till last. And joyful. Yeah. Have you ever seen a joyful religious person? I don't think I have. Most of the time it looks like they've been sucking on a lemon. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know, but fill in the blanks of what that looks like. But why is that? Why are religious people not really operating in fullness of joy? I think it's because, you know, they never really know, am I doing okay? Religion, you see, doesn't give that assurance. Religion doesn't give the assurance when people ask questions like, am I doing okay? Am I matching up? Am I doing enough? See, right there is the difference between every religion, including religious Christianity, and a radical real relationship with Jesus Christ. And the difference there is the joy factor, is the joy factor. I said it before the other week, I'll say it again. You show me a religious person, I'll show you a person that's struggling in the realms of joy. You show me a person who's walking in relationship with Jesus Christ, and even when they go through tough times, even when they go through difficulties and trials, there's a level of joy that cannot be explained. And that's why the Apostle Paul, he wrote to the Romans, and he said this in Romans chapter 15. He said, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. He knew they were going to go through some trials and some difficult stuff. But Paul said, may the God of hope fill you with joy. May you still know joy in the midst of all of those trials and the crisis that you go through. One of my favorite chapters in the Bible is James chapter 1. James says to the early church, he says these words, James chapter 1, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. When you become a follower of Jesus, does that mean that the trials go away? No, I've got to be honest, since 1982, I think I've faced more trials in my life than before that time when I look at my timeline, the timeline of my life. But in the midst of those trials, in the midst of those challenges, we can know joy that is just not understandable to the people around. And then as Roger was talking about last week, wasn't that awesome, talking about heaven? You can see the joy on his face when you're talking about heaven and our future hope. We get through this life with joy, and then there is a future hope that's not my subject today, but it's still got to be put on the table. That's why we are joyful people, because no matter what happens in this world, no matter what happens with COVID and our world and all the craziness of our world at the moment, we have a future hope, and it's called heaven. C.S. Lewis, the writer of the Narnia Chronicles, he said this line, it's great. He said, joy is the serious business of heaven. Joy is going to be the serious business of heaven for you and me, who are not in religion, but know a real relationship with Jesus. So how do you know the curse of religion is affecting you? How do you know? You might be watching this and going like, well, I don't know whether I'm religious or not. Well, you know, if you want to know that, you've got to go back maybe to last week, because we got into Galatians last week, where Paul talked to those crazy Galatians. But in closing this morning, I'm just going to give you three pointers from what I've just said. Here's the other side of the coin. If religion is starting to get into your heart and starting to affect you, then the first thing will be pride. First thing will be pride. It'll be that kind of sense of criticism of other people, being judgmental. Oh, friends, you see that so much, don't you, on the internet. You know, even last week got a message sent to me after doing my recording, and it was just a bit critical, a bit judgmental. It's like, oh, bless them, Lord, bless them, God. But, oh, most of all, get that religious bit out of them that's causing them to respond with pride and arrogance. And then secondly, a lack of assurance and confidence. A lack of assurance. Just no assurance that you know where you're going. You know God's got it all in hand. Even during these crazy times of weird things happening in our world, we can just have an assurance that Jesus has got it and we're in a walk and a relationship with him. And lastly, like I just pointed out, no joy. No joy. That's a big test. You know, when you start to let religion in, everything you do starts to become a drudge. Your prayer life becomes, you know, doing something for God, doing anything becomes just like, do I have to? Oh, do I have to turn up? Do I have to be there? All the wrong questions. When you're walking in relationship with Jesus, there is a joy and an ease to the things that you do for God. It doesn't come from having to. It comes from just a response. It comes from a reactive response to what Jesus has done in your heart. So in closing, I asked this on the first week. Do that inventory again maybe this week. Just ask again. Just be, let the conviction of the Holy Spirit just go into your heart for a few moments and ask again, what part of your walk with Jesus has turned into religiosity? And here's the great thing. When you find that place, don't be condemned. But when you find that place, let the presence, the fresh water, the cooling, refreshing spring rain of Jesus just rain into that part of your life. If you find yourself becoming critical about things and everything, you see the news and it's just, don't be condemned, but just let Jesus's spirit flood over that. Just maybe you need to switch the TV off, switch that news off. Maybe you watch it for a whole half an hour. Just watch 10 minutes, watch the main headlines and then just switch it off. Just let the presence of Jesus flood into your heart. If there's an area in your life where you've just lost your joy, where, yeah, you're trying to be happy, you're trying to do happy things, you're trying to go on a holiday and you found, you go on holiday and you came back and the happiness wasn't there. No, no, friends, you'll never find happiness in a holiday. You'll never find it in anything that you buy, anything that you can purchase. That's not where you find joy, real joy. You only find it in Jesus. And so when you're on holiday during the season, maybe you just need to remember that. On one of those mornings you wake up and the sun is up and it's holiday time. There's nothing you'll eat that day. There's no excursion you can go on that can really bring true joy. Maybe you just need to find a few moments. Just take 10 minutes. Get away from the noise. Get away from the pool. Get away from wherever you are. And just find that deep, refreshing joy that only Jesus can bring. Well, God bless you. I hope you've enjoyed this today. I'll be back for the last session next week in Losing My Religion. In the meantime, enjoy the journey and enjoy this summertime that we're in right now. May God bless you this week, wherever you're going, whatever you're doing, in Jesus' name.